This is the second video in a series of videos about how stars work. My last video talked about how stars normally operate. This video will talk about what happens to a star as it gets old. The Sun is a great star. It's been really good to us. It's made the Earth a nice, warm, comfortable home for all of us. But the Sun is slowly changing. In a billion years, we might want to think about relocating, or at least start shopping around for new planets. Here's why. Last time, we talked about the ideal gas law. Pressure is proportional to temperature divided by volume times the number of particles. This number is going down. When we do fusion, we're combining four particles into one. As the number of particles goes down, the pressure goes down too. Now there's not enough pressure to hold off gravity, so the core contracts, which raises the temperature and raises the pressure until it's strong enough to hold off gravity again. As a star burns, the number of particles goes down and it gets hotter and brighter. The drop in the particle count means that the Sun gets brighter by 1/1,000,000% every century. In the short term, it makes no difference. But over a billion years, it's important. As a star brightens over billions of years, it will continue to turn hydrogen into helium in its core. But eventually, it will run out of hydrogen. In 5 billion years, the Sun will have used up all the hydrogen in the core. So it won't burn in the core. It will start burning it in a shell around the core. This will cause some big changes. The Sun will expand. Its radius will expand 200 times over. It will grow past the orbits of Mercury and Venus. The Sun will swallow up Mercury and Venus. As it grows, its surface will cool. Its color will change from yellow to red. It will become a red giant. Why does this happen? Why do stars become red giants? Scientists have been debating this for years. They're still debating this. They think they understand the physics of stars pretty well, but scientists understand stars using differential equations, using complex numeric simulations. They can simulate a star in a computer, and these simulations match the stars we see in the night sky. The simulations predict that stars become red giants. So we have an answer to the question. If you do lots of complex calculations, you discover that stars become red giants. But that's not a very satisfying answer. I would love to share with you a simple, intuitive explanation. But that's what everyone's arguing about, not the simulations. Just to show you how contentious this debate is, let me give you some of the explanations out there for why stars become red giants. It could be the increase in the gravitational field from the condensed core, or it could be from the shell's layer of polytropic index greater than 5, or the singular point on the UV plane, or deep surface convection, or thermal instabilities, or rising entropy in the envelope. Which explanation is right? I have no idea. But I can tell you what the simulations say. They say that when you switch from fusion in the core to fusion in a shell around the core, several things happen. The core contracts, the outer envelope expands and turns red, and the shell is now hot enough to do CNO fusion, which means there is convection. Next, we need to talk about pressure. I have talked about how pressure comes from heat, based on the ideal gas law. But heat is just one of several things that produce pressure. Pressure can also come from radiation and something called electron degeneracy. Light is a form of radiation, and light produces pressure. Radiation pressure is most important at high temperatures and low densities. At extreme temperatures, radiation pressure can be so powerful, it can rip apart a star. If a star forms above 100 solar masses, its core will be so hot and bright, it will rip apart the star. So there aren't any stars above 100 solar masses. Now let's look at electron degeneracy. Electrons can have a spin of a half or negative half. Quantum mechanics says that two electrons with the same spin cannot occupy the same quantum state. This is called the Pauli exclusion principle. This principle is very important for chemistry. It explains why electrons are found in shells around the nucleus, and why only a few electrons can occupy the lowest energy states. This principle is important whenever you cram electrons together. At high densities, the electrons are forced into high energy states. For a star, this means that there's another pressure resisting gravity. When the electrons are close, the degeneracy pressure prevents gravity from pushing them closer. stars become more degenerate as they grow old. When the Sun becomes a red giant, its helium core will contract and will become dense and degenerate. Over time, the temperature will slowly rise until it's hot enough to burn helium. Helium is much harder to burn than hydrogen. Hydrogen fuses at 3 million degrees, but helium needs 100 million degrees. Two helium nuclei can fuse together into beryllium-8, but beryllium-8 is very unstable. It normally decays in a quadrillionth of a second, but if it's hot enough, there's a small chance that another helium nuclei can smash into the beryllium in that tiny fraction of a second. This produces carbon-12 and releases lots of energy. And that carbon can fuse into oxygen with just a little more heat. Eventually, the Sun will be hot enough to burn helium. Helium burning produces lots of heat. But something strange happens now, because the core is degenerate. Ordinarily, heat is the main source of pressure. As temperature rises, the pressure rises too. Rising pressure causes the gas to expand and then cool. Ordinarily, the temperature is controlled. But in a very dense gas, the main source of pressure isn't heat, it's electron degeneracy. When you raise the temperature, the pressure barely changes. The core does not expand and it does not cool. It remains at the higher temperature. At this temperature, helium can burn even faster, which leads to even higher temperature. The temperature and the nuclear reactions feed off each other. The result is an explosion. It's called the helium flash. For a few seconds, the flash can be 100 billion times the luminosity of the Sun. But this explosion happens deep beneath the surface. Several flashes can occur. They cause the core to expand and end its degeneracy. Once the core is no longer degenerate, it will burn helium in a more moderate, less explosive way. Heavier stars don't have helium flashes. Above 2.5 solar masses, they get hot enough to burn helium before their cores become degenerate. On the other hand, small stars never burn helium. Stars below half a solar mass never get hot enough to burn helium. Remember, a star becomes a red giant when it starts fusing in a shell rather than the core. But once core fusion returns, it stops being a red giant. It goes back to having a larger core and a smaller outer envelope, which is hotter and less red. The star will then burn helium in the core for a while. But the story repeats itself. Eventually, the core will run out of helium. When that happens, it will start burning in a shell around the core, and it will become a red giant again. Helium shell burning is unstable. Thermal instabilities cause the star to pulse. As the star gets brighter, the outer envelope of the star can be blown away by a superwind. And we can see this. Around these stars, we can see giant plumes of dust and gas blowing away from them. These are called planetary nebulae. This is a confusing name because it has nothing to do with planets. Stars like the Sun will stop here. They can't burn anything past helium. But stars above 8 solar masses are so hot that they can burn heavier elements. At half a billion degrees, carbon fuses into neon. At a billion degrees, neon fuses into oxygen. At 2 billion degrees, oxygen fuses into silicon. Finally, at 3 billion degrees, silicon fuses into nickel and iron. Massive stars look like an onion with many layers, hydrogen on top, then helium, carbon, oxygen, neon, silicon, nickel, and iron. Let's look at a graph that shows you how much energy you can get out of these reactions. This graph shows you the binding energy of various nuclei. You can see there's a big jump between hydrogen and helium. This means that turning hydrogen into helium releases lots of energy. There's less of a jump between helium and carbon. This reaction produces less energy. If you go through these reactions, you see that each reaction produces less energy than the one before. Remember, a star needs to produce enough energy and enough pressure to resist gravity. Otherwise, it will contract and the temperature will keep rising until it does produce enough energy. You can get lots of energy burning hydrogen, so you don't need to burn a lot of it. But then you get less energy from burning helium, so you have to burn more of it. You need to burn more helium, so the helium doesn't last as long. Stars spend most of their lives burning hydrogen. This reaction is so powerful, it can sustain a star through most of its life. A star that's 18 solar masses will burn hydrogen in its core for 10 million years. It will then burn helium for 1 million years, then carbon for 300 years, then neon for just 5 months, then oxygen for 6 months. Finally, it will burn silicon for just 2 days. At this point, the star has nothing left to burn, and so it must die. In this video, we've gone through the final stages of a star's life. In my next video, we'll talk about how stars die. For more astronomical videos, please click to subscribe.